believe in God, probably in some sense. Many Christians, myself included, wear a cross around our necks as a sign of our devotion. Back in college, I had a conversation with someone who had been confronted about her wearing a cross. The person who had confronted her did so on theological grounds. If her boyfriend were shot, they asked, would you wear a bullet? She replied with some of the most Christian words I've ever heard, if you took it from me, of course I would. The cross is a significant symbol in Christianity, and rightly so. There is, of course, a theological point to be made here. The cross was used by the Roman Empire as both a torturous method of execution and as a show of strength. Other tyrannical regimes have put the heads of their enemies on spikes as a warning to those who would disobey or rebel against their authority, and the cross falls right in line with this spirit. When we talk about how Jesus was executed because his message of love was and is a threat to empire, the method of execution, the cross, is how we know. Jesus' willingness to be crucified, to be tortured to death, was a supreme act of heroism. In some church dormants, you can see the Greek word nika, meaning victory, around or near a cross, and we claim victory because from the height of that cross he was nailed to, Jesus could utterly disregard empire and show them that even in their cruelest display of might, God's love for us was mightier. And in the agonizing obedience of that sacrifice, Jesus showered the world in love. But the author of today's reading examines a different message that Rome wanted to convey through that cross. Shame. Traditionally, artists have put a loincloth on Jesus' body on a crucifix, but historically, people were naked when they were crucified, their entire broken bodies on shameful display. The Romans wanted to remove any remnants of power their victims held, any lingering agency, any last sense of dignity. So they destroyed their spirits with shame, while their bodies were destroyed with pain and suffocation. Today, we can see past the shame in Jesus' crucifixion, so I'd like to use another important symbol of Jesus' passion, the crown of thorns. Now, you won't see this worn as a devotional act. That might be a bit much. But you do see it in a lot of Christian imagery, both displayed on Jesus' head on a crucifix and by itself on vestments that hang on ministers and in the sanctuary. It goes along with the cross. In our tradition, it was still on Jesus' head when they crucified him, but it is also worthy of examination by itself. In some gospel accounts, before he was nailed to the cross, Jesus was whipped. He was given a purple robe, purple being a sign of royalty. He was given a reed for a scepter and a crown of thorns. He was then mockingly bowed to as king, all the while standing there silently and alone. His friends were nowhere to be found, and no allies came to his defense. In one of the communion prayers in my tradition, we say that God sent God's only Son, Jesus, to share our human nature to live and die as one of us. And on the first Good Friday, it was as important for God to share in our shame as it was for God to share in the brutality of our state-sponsored murder. Our redemption can be found in the crown of thorns as much as in the cross. The crown, as we heard in that wonderful poem, was a deliberate symbol. Jesus talked often about the kingdom of God in his teaching, and that, of course, got Rome's attention. The kingdom of God is not a kingdom in the sense the Romans knew it, nor in the sense that we know it today. The kingdom of God is not a kingdom of power and might, but a kingdom of liberation. The kingdom of God is one in which the tyranny of oppression and exploitation is totally destroyed. And in its place, a life and love and wholeness for all of God's creation. This is dangerous stuff to the forces of empire in the first century, and it's still dangerous to those forces So they did what they could to squash that rebellion. They marched it. And then they killed its leader. Once, as part of the sermon, the deacon at my church asked the congregation to write down the things in their lives they would like to let go of to bring them closer to God, things they wanted to give to God to let God handle for them. The first one that I wrote down was shame. And I'd be surprised if I was the only one who wrote that, either that abstraction or a particular thing about which they were ashamed. I also guess that a lot of us here know this feeling of shame. Maybe we're ashamed of what we've done, or of who we are, or of what we see when we look in the mirror, both allegorically and physically. But beloved, God is good, and Jesus is right there with us in our shame. Jesus was there with the 11 disciples in the upper room, who must have felt great shame as they cowered in hiding while their rabbi and spiritual leader was being tortured to death. And Jesus was there with Peter, who so boldly proclaimed his loyalty, yet could not help but deny that he even knew Jesus in order to save his own skin. And Jesus is there with James and John, sons of Zebedee, who had said they wanted to sit with Jesus at his right on his left hand, but couldn't even stay awake in the garden. And in the Gospel of Matthew, we hear that Judas, who betrayed even God himself, hanged himself in shame. And Jesus is right there with him, too. And shame can kill us just as easily as it killed Judas. How many times have we avoided a test because we were ashamed? How many awkward phone calls have we put off? How much time and money and effort have we put into working around things that we've done or not done that caused us shame? And it was us. For those who struggle with addiction, shame is tremendous fuel for the fire that will eventually consume their whole being. Much of the work of the 12 steps, in fact, centers around removing the shame built up over years of addiction and addressing behaviors that go along with it. The violence of shame can be turned outward, lashing against strangers or family, especially intimate partners, as people who are ashamed try to bolster themselves against those who they perceive as weaker. Violence against women and others minoritized by gender stems from the same place as shame, and the fact that there is even something called a gay panic or a trans panic defense when one is on trial for violence committed against someone who is or is perceived as gay or trans speaks to the extent that the state will go to legitimize the idea that associations with those identities is something to be ashamed of. Homophobia and transphobia are applied, misogyny and xenophobia, a fear of women and femininity. And the fact that we as queer people are shamed for transgressions against the sexual and gender status quo comes down to the very way our beings challenge the superiority of the masculine that is baked into everything in our society. But again, God is good. And God does not need us to be ashamed. There are times when we offer it. There are certainly times when we are as ashamed before God as we could be before anyone or anything else, but God does not need it. Nowhere in the Bible is shame expressed as appropriate penance for sin. You may have come from Christian traditions that have told you to express shame to God for what you've done. You may have come from traditions that have told you to express shame to God for who you are. And I will tell you, and I will tell anyone who told this to you, beloved, that that is not of God. God loves you precisely how you are in your full, beautiful self. God made you fearfully and wonderfully. God knew you before you were in your mother's womb. God does not need you to be ashamed of God's wondrous creation. Rather, the opposite. And the opposite of shame is, of course, pride. Happy pride. And this is one of the myriad reasons that I hold no truck with those who would tell us that pride in itself is a sin.
Arrogance? Sure. Hubris? I'll buy that. But pride? Why did pride be a sin when God called us very good? God is proud of us, and God loves us unconditionally. Our job is to love each other just as unconditionally. Because God is love, and look around, beloved, love is the power behind where all of this lies. So as the epistle writer continues, consider the one who endured such hostility against himself from sinners so that you may not grow weary or lose heart. We can't get weary. Love is work. Love is important work. And God's love for us is the reason God was willing to die on the cross. Our love for each other is what God asks in return. And in understanding that God already has our same will in hand, we are able to put that same aside and not let it get in the way of loving others. And we are to pursue this love with everyone and not sell it out for a few bucks or a little security. Because pride, like salvation, is so much more about us collectively than each of us individually. Individual pride looks like a gay bar posting a Smirnoff pride ad while substance abuse runs rampant through our community. Individual pride looks like a police department float in a city-sponsored pride parade where the same cops riding that float on a Sunday were violently breaking up an unsanctioned queer liberation gathering on Friday. Individual pride looks like queer gatekeeping, whether that's a middle-class gay family complaining about how flamboyant decadence at pride is embarrassing, or toxic rhetoric against homonormativity that would brand some of us insufficiently queer. Collective pride remembers that while Martha P. Johnson and Sylvia Rivera threw those first bricks, it was them walking hand-in-hand with the assimilationist homophile movement that got the first marches for gay liberation off the ground. Collective pride is every single one of the letters in LGBTQIA+, including and probably especially the plus, getting full and equal respect and visibility. Collective pride knows that without sex workers, we are not celebrating pride today. Collective pride does not allow a 17-year-old trans kid to detransition in Missouri because her family couldn't pick up and move to Illinois. And collective pride understands that a queer liberation movement that does not put the needs and concerns of queer and trans people of color first is neither queer nor liberating for any of us. And as it says in the reading, see to it that no one becomes like Esau, an immoral and godless person who allowed trans women of color to be disposable because gay marriage was an easier sell. I'm paraphrasing. Earlier in the Epistle to the Hebrews, before the lesson we heard, by his death, Jesus has destroyed the power of death, and I believe that through his shaming, Jesus has destroyed the power of shame, too. God's love is stronger than shame. God's almighty, unconditional love for us tears us from our shame, walks us through our shame, and brings us out of our shame, and into new life, into God's kingdom, into communion with God and with each other. That's the dangerous part. That is why the powers of empire have worked so hard to quash and to co-opt our pride. Because when we can be truly in communion with God and with one another, when our pride, our liberation, and our salvation are collective, we supplant that empire with the kingdom of God. A kingdom that has no aristocracy, no billionaires, no corporate floats, and no king, but a homeless troublemaker who died a slave's death. A king they tried to shame, but who rose from that shame to bring us everlasting pride. Happy Pride, beloved. Amen.